Hey everyone, this is John from EastCoastArmory.com, and I'm here today with a model showcase video for this 1/6 scale German SDKFZ 250 Halftrack. The model that you see here is an older model. The model is out of my own personal collection and is not for sale and or purchase. This model here I built back in 2005 and has been sitting in my collection ever since. After the completion of my 222 armored car, I was evaluating the collection and saw that this model here had fallen to some disarray. I went ahead and made some repairs to the model, and now that it's fully repaired, it could go back on display in the collection. We'll be going over the base starter kit, the features, as well as a quick overview of the mods that were made to the kit when the model was first built in this video. First, a quick walk around the model. For the base model, the model that you see here started off as a 1/6 scale ABS plastic kit from the company Armor Hobbies. Armor Hobbies was a small-time model making outfit. They produced two kits in 1/6 scale. The company itself was started in about 2005 and they closed up shop in 2007. The two kits that they produced was this SDKFZ 250 Alt, as well as a soft cab version of the 250 Halftrack. The Alt version of the Halftrack was the first kit to be released. This kit here was all comprised out of molded ABS plastic parts. The parts themselves were very basic in detailing, however, assembled very easy and very effortlessly. The entire model itself was bolt together assembly, and one of the charms of these kits was that they were very easy to assemble and did offer the model builder a nice great base in which to add custom detail parts in order to improve it from the stock setup. These vehicles featured a working front suspension with steering, individual workable track links, as well as wheels that can roll on nice sturdy steel or aluminum shafts. The model did come with a very basic, simplistic interior, which consisted of nothing more than a steering wheel and two seats. The rest of the interior detailing would have to be built upon the modeler. As for the quality of the detailing, as well as the way the kit assembles itself, it really felt as if the kit was a scaled up version of the very old 1/35th scale 250 kit from Nitto, also Blue Tank. The model has very similar assembly features, as well as other components, such as the way the suspension connects to the chassis. It was almost a mirror image on the Nitto kit. If anyone has ever built any of the older Nitto kits, you'll know exactly what I'm referring to. Another positive attribute that these kits had were the price. The base starter kits retailed for about $150 to approximately $250, from what I can remember. These kits were very popular and well received amongst the 1/6 scale armor modeling community. About 2 years after the release of this kit, Armor Hobbies released another 1/6 scale offering, and like I mentioned before, was that of the Demmog soft cab version of the 250 half track. That kit retailed for along the lines of the same price. However, it utilized the exact same recycled running gear from this kit here. Unfortunately, rather than using a molded ABS plastic body like this kit did, that kit went ahead and utilized a vacuum form styrene body. These kits required a lot more work to build properly, and because of which became very unpopular very quickly. After the negative press about that kit there, Armor Hobbies folded up shop shortly after. If anyone is interested in trying to track down one of these kits here were fairly prolific and are a lot easier to find compared to some of the other 1/6 scale model offerings that I have posted on my video listings. These kits here can only be found on the internet, and are you have a good chance on scoring one of these kits either from eBay, from several of the other online 1/6 scale retailers like Monkey Depot, or your best bet to track one of these down is to sign up to one of the 1/6 scale armor modeling communities and chat rooms on the internet. The biggest and best one that comes to mind is 6 Scale Army Group. All of the links are listed below in the video listing. Also, in case anyone is wondering whether or not I know if these kits will be making a re-release or return, unfortunately, I have no information or knowledge of who currently owns the rights to the Armor Hobbies products, nor do I know of any information of any future re-release. My model, I purchased brand new when the kits first came out, again in the winter of 2005 timeframe. The model that you see here is an older model. There are some features and details on it which are a lot more primitive compared to the type of work that you see being put on my more recent 1/6 scale creations. All of the components that you see on this model here are all one-off. None of the parts were ever made it to mold or were ever added to the EastCoastArmory.com product line. For my build, I just wanted a simple reconnaissance variation of the SDKFZ 250 Alt, which is the version that you see here. This particular vehicle here has a somewhat interesting history in that this model was actually built to the condition you see here in about a month's time. The purpose of which was to enter a online model contest, which was being hosted by 6 Scale Army Group. At the time, there was a Armor Hobbies 250 contest build, in which members of the forum would build their 250s and send pictures and would be awarded prizes in the contest. This model here was entered along with several others, and of all of the entries, this model here took second place. Starting with the models front suspension, the Armor Hobbies kit did feature a steerable front drive wheels. In addition to the front drive wheels, the steering wheel also pivoted on the inside, similar to what you would see on die-cast car models. Now, unfortunately, due to the addition of the detailed interior, the steering wheel system had to have been dropped, as the 250 steering wheel has a different pitch to it compared to the kit original. In order for me to make a detailed interior, the pivoting steering wheel feature had to have been deleted. However, the front wheels are still fully functional. The rubber tires that you see here are made out of real rubber and have a plastic center hub. The hubs have been detailed with their center fastener detailing. This was scratch built by myself. In addition to that being scratch built, the skid rail or skid plate that you see on the bottom of the vehicle was also scratch built. This was made out of sheet metal and was bent and detailed to the exact same dimensions as found on a real SDKFZ 250 that I was using for reference. Here we have the two front tow eyes. These were the kit originals, however, they have been modified. As you see, they have the small little retention clip found on the fronts. There are mirror images on each other. In addition, the way they connect to the frame or the chassis was also changed. On the stock kit, you simply take these and glue them into a peg, which is found on the stock kit. On the real 250, they are elevated past the frame via some brackets. The brackets were all fabricated out of sheet metal and fastened to the stock model. This was another little bit of piece of detailing that was added. On the real 250, the upper and lower chassis are bolted together with a set of bulkheads. These on the real vehicle follow all throughout the length of the hull. On the model here, I just fabricated the front section, as this is the section that is visible from the exterior portion of the vehicle. Everything you see here is a mirror image on the opposite side. Moving up from the wheels takes us to the no-tech light and the bow headlights. The bow headlights that you see are the kit originals. They are molded hollow. And for extra detailing, I went ahead and fabricated the lens detailing, which is found on the slit. It's some clear plastic with some clear epoxy added to the back of it in order to simulate that of a glass lens. As for the no-tech light, this here is a resin accessory from panzerwork.com. The piece here was simply painted, weathered, and added to the model. This is one of the few aftermarket components which is found on this model, and it was actually a more recent addition and was added a few years after the completion of the model itself. Moving our way to the fender indicators as well as the side view mirror. Just like what was seen recent on my 222 armored car, the 250 is no different and does have fender indicators mounted on each side. These are a distinctive feature found on German World War II wheeled vehicles. Unlike the 222, in which those were a Panzerwerk accessory, these components here were scratch built by myself. They're just simply turned resin that was done on the lathe. The mirror is the same size mirror that I still use today, and the dish pan was again fabricated as a one-off on the lathe. The rods are simple brass with a metal 6mm BB, which was drilled and soldered to the rod. Moving our way to the tools. The tools that you see here are all scratch built, with the exception of the shovel and the sledgehammer. Both of these components were originally supplied with the 250 kit. However, the wooden handles were fabricated by myself and the plastic handles were simply removed. The scissor that you see on the front was scratch built by myself and again is fabricated out of wood and resin and plastic. All of the tool mounts and tool posts are made out of metal and are fully functional. The exhaust manifold system on the 250 is a very distinctive feature found on German Halftracks. The exhaust emerges from the engine and it would enter into a large muffler system that we have here. Now the muffler on many of the German Halftracks are covered up with this sheet metal box in order to keep the heat down. The grills are very distinctive, and this portion here was originally supplied with the 250 kit. However, the detailing was much more rudimentary compared to the unit that you see here. The louvers here were scratch built out of aluminum, and the whole piece was re-detailed in order to match the specs of the real one that I was following. The exhaust pipe was turned out of resin, and the bottom of the exhaust was also turned out of resin stock. Moving our way takes us to the turn indicator. Just like what was mentioned on the 222, German wheeled vehicles of the period featured a turn indicator, which when the driver would signal, a large arrow would pop out of this box here, indicating which way the vehicle was turning. This unit here is all scratch built out of sheet metal. It's bent, folded, and soldered to shape. Again, this is another component here that was released in resin by panzerwerk.com, and his said it was also very highly recommended. Moving our way to the suspension. The suspension of the model is probably one of the strongest attributes that this kit had going for it. All of the suspension, which includes the sprocket, the wheels, and the track, are all made out of the same ABS plastic. The track is fully workable, and several people were able to successfully convert this static kit to radio controlled. The wheels connect to the hull and to each other via aluminum rods, which run along the bottom portion of the vehicle that are contained inside of the hull, of the interior floor pans. They are not exposed and are also very strong. They are pre-tapped, and all the wheels simply bolt to these components, like I mentioned earlier. They're, on the original kit, the hubcaps are exposed, and all of the hubcap detailing that you see on this kit here were scratch-built by myself. The wheels are adequate and very basic in getting the point across that it's a 250. However, Panzerwerk did have better accurate resin wheels, which, in my opinion, would have been a better accessory to add to this kit if you want to go for the extra detail edge, and if you're willing to fork over the extra budget for the replacement parts. Same could also be said for the sprocket and his track. However, for the kit sprocket, the hubcap was scratch built, but hubcap aside, the sprocket was adequately detailed out of box. The only thing that you see here that was added by myself outside of the hubcap was that of the little rubber blocks, which are bolted to the sprocket via two little fasteners. All the fastener detailing, as well as the rubber block detailing, was scratch built. Now, one side effect of adding the rubber blocks is that it will change your track tension to the nice tight track appearance that you see here. If the rubber blocks are not present, the track will have more of a slack to it, which, in my opinion, does help with the accuracy of the build. But if you go ahead and add one more link compared to the unit here, the track will be too slacked. So for the purpose of this build, I have it in its tight configuration. Also, another feature which in today would be more considered a ding is that this vehicle here has no suspension detailing, no torsion bar or functional suspension. It's a rigid suspension. There is no flex to it. And more than likely, if I was building the vehicle today, I would more than likely modify the kit to have a working suspension. Moving our way to the tracks, the kit tracks are the way you see here, and like again, they were made out of the same ABS plastic. Now, the tracks consisted of three components. You had the link, the pin, and the little rectangular plate that would go in this little location here. The purpose of that little block was due to the way the tracks are molded. The tracks are pre-drilled, and so no modifications are needed to be made to the track in that regard. However, because of the tooling, there would be a small little notch in the center portion here of the track pad, in which these small little blocks would be glued in place. Like I said before, these tracks here do the job of giving you a basic track. However, if you really want to super detail the vehicle to its full extent, there was for a period of time aftermarket track from panzerwerk.com, which was more accurate in appearance compared to its stock offering. However, if you are making your kit here, specifically if you're RC converting it, the stock plastic tracks are a better option. Another ding on the stock track is the fact that the center hinge portion is exposed and you can see the pin. Again, this is due to the tooling required in order to mold these tracks in the media that you see here. And for the majority of builders of these kits, the stock tracks were perfectly suffice. Moving our way to the back of the vehicle takes us to first the rubber mud flaps. This is one portion that was scratch built by myself. The rubber is just a thin piece of rubber, I believe was from an old bicycle inner tube, and was cut to shape and mounted to the fender. On the bottom we have a metal strip with fastener detailing, as well as fasteners on the top portion. This detailing came directly off of a real Restore 250 that I was using for reference. Other scratch build detailings include the license plate, the rear no-tech light, the convoy reflector, as well as the little blister here on the bottom portion of the rear escape hatch. This portion is absent on the stock kit and was fabricated by myself out of some strips of plastic. The tow hitch is all scratch built, as is the jerry can rack. Again, these detailing coming straight from a real 250. On the opposite side, we have the same mirror image of the mud flap, the same license plate, and a scratch built convoy light. Moving to the opposite side takes us to first one of the largest bit of details, and that is of the side storage cabinet. The cabinet that you see here was not supplied with the kit. In fact, was all scratch built by myself. Now, unlike my more contemporary builds, in which for a component like this, I fabricate it out of sheet metal and have the components be functional. On this model here, the fabrication is all made out of sheet styrene, and the doors are purely for detail purposes only and are non-functional. Because of the media that I utilized to fabricate the bins, after about a decade of sitting around, some of the plastic panels begin to have some warpage to it. This is one reason why I abandoned this media for components like this and switched over to sheet metal. However, having said that, the warpage is not necessarily an issue, specifically for a component like this cabin, which on the real vehicle was comprised out of very thin sheet metal and dinged and banged very easily. During the restoration, I just went ahead and flared in the dings and dents to the model's paint pattern and weathering, and everything blends in pretty well. Moving to the front takes us to the opposite side tools. Just like with the shovel and the sledgehammer, the pickaxe you see here was also the kit original, and again, the only thing that was replaced was the handle. The small miniature axe that you see here was all scratch built out of resin and wood. Moving from the tools takes us to the side storage bin. The storage bin that you see here was the kit supply one, however, was modified to have better face detailing for the latch and door mechanism of the storage compartment. This component here is non-functional and is purely just for detail. Moving our way up to the hood and engine section of the model, this model here does feature fully operational hatches on both the sides and the front. However, there is no interior detailing on this model, so opening the hatches is really a moot point. However, if anyone does get one of these kits and does plan on making an engine compartment detailing, the functional hatches is a great asset. Moving our way rearward takes us to the ventilation grills. The grills were molded into the model. However, I went ahead and added extra detailing of meshwork and replacement box frames. The visors on the model that you see here are also a little functional piece. They flip open and lock in that position there. These visors on my model are mostly stock. I did add some clear acrylic detailing for that of prisms, which will be seen on the interior portion of the build. Moving towards the top takes us to the gutter, which is on the front portion here of the 250. This again here was another piece that was fabricated out of a PVC tube, which was cut, bent, and shaped and mounted in the way you see it here. Moving our way to the machine gun, the 250 utilizes an MG34 machine gun in a shielded mount. The mount can pivot left and right. The mount itself is all fabricated and scratch built out of sheet metal and brass. The machine gun itself is a 1/6 scale accessory from the company Yellow Submarine. Yellow Submarine is an older company who made a very small selection of 1/6 scale weapons. This company was around in, I want to say, 2001 to about 2003. They made several weapon sets and then folded up shop soon after. At the time, this machine gun here was state of the art and was very nicely detailed. In fact, today the gun is still highly touted and, in my opinion, is still one of the better MG34s that were released. The gun that you see it is left as is, and no mods or any type of modifications were made to this weapon in the configuration that you see here. Moving on from the MG34 takes us to the antenna base. The antenna base you see here is all scratch built out of brass and metal, as well as resin. Simply fabricated and then mounted to the model. Moving back takes us to the MG34 travel lock. The 250, just like many other German World War II half tracks, had two machine gun locations, one in the front and one in the rear. When there would be a gun mounted in the rear, the machine gun would be stowed in this format here, and this system here would simply open up and then clamp over the barrel section of the 34. For the model that you see here, this is a detail piece only and is non-functional. It's all fabricated out of sheet metal and is all soldered together. Same can be said about the rear machine gun mount. This piece here is all scratch built and is also fabricated out of lengths of brass tube and again all soldered together. This was one portion of the model that was damaged during the years of sitting on my shelf. I presume one of my cats bumped into it and it actually put pressure on this component here, cracking the gun off and a part of the plastic from the rear portion of the top of the hull. As you can see, I went ahead and thoroughly blended in all of the damage, and the damage has been buffed away and is no longer remotely evident on the model. On the rear portion of the vehicle takes us to, again, another gutter. This gutter here is over the rear escape hatch. It's just fabricated out of a bent piece of steel and then mounted. The door itself is also fully functional. And does have some detailing added to it. Here we can see one of my acrylic prisms that was added on the periscope, and the locking latch mechanism is also scratch built out of plastic and brass. In this location here would have been a first aid kit. Since I don't have the first aid kit, the first aid kit mounts are present. Moving our way to the interior of the model takes us to first this large storage locker bin that we have here. This bin here is all scratch built and was not supplied with the kit. It's fabricated out of sheet styrene, and again, the hinge detailing and as well as everything else is purely for detail purposes only and is non-functional. Moving forward takes us to one of the collapsible chairs. This one here is all fabricated out of brass, and the seat pads are actually real soft pads, which was added when I fabricated the model. On the real 250, this component here can actually fold up and fold away in order to free up more space on the interior portion of the vehicle. On the top portion here, we have a rifle rack for 98K Mausers. The rack itself is all fabricated out of sheet metal and is also fully functional. If I hit this little latch, it swings down and I can remove the 98K. Now, all the 98Ks you see here were all from stock from 21st Century Toys and were left as is and unmodified. Really, all of the components on the interior of the model are basically out of a time capsule from when this vehicle was first built. Here's a quick detail of the rifle butt cups. And on the front portion, you can see there's a small little strip of wood which helps protect the bore end, or the muzzle end, of the rifle. On the opposite side, we have here a ammunition rack for the MG34 machine gun ammo drums. We have here a bench seat. The bench seat also doubles as a little rack in order to put equipment in. The bottom bench has its distinctive rivet pattern upholstery, and I believe on the real half track this too can pivot upward in order to have more storage space below. As for the ranging poles, this was again right out of the real 250 I was using for reference. All these details here are scratch built, as well as all the other details you see as equipment racks and front interior detailing. Moving our way to the front of the interior takes us to first the transmission. The transmission that you see on this model here is all scratch built. The materials are wood, metal, and resin. The transmission is comprised of several different components, from the bottom portion of the transmission to the small little levers and final drive up front to the top cover itself. Top cover, if I can remember, I fabricated out of a piece of styrene that I vacuum formed over a wooden pattern. Moving on to the seats, the front driver and radio operator seats on this model are all scratch built. They are made out of brass and are all soldered together. The seat pads themselves are a separate component that I strapped to the frames, just like on the real vehicle. Also, like on the real vehicle, the springs that are on the backs of the seats are all made out of metal and are all soldered in place to the frame itself. It adds for a very realistic detailing, and if I can remember, it was probably one of the hardest pieces to fabricate at the time. Moving from the seats takes us to the controls. As you can see, all of the shifting and clutch mechanisms are all present, as well as the gas and clutch pedals. Here we can see the steering wheel, and this is what I was referring to earlier in the video. As you can see, just like on many other German World War II AFV, the steering wheel, after it comes out of the firewall, goes directly downward. It's probably really difficult to drive. However, like I said before, making the detail in this format here and making the front wheel still pivot proved to be impossible, so I just left it static as is. The instrument panel that you see here is also all scratch built. And right next to the instrument panel is a hollow box. That there is the frame for what would be a radio. Fortunately, I don't have the radio detailing that can be simply inserted into that position if and whenever a radio I end up acquiring. Moving down to the bottom, you can see some other interior detailing and rivet detailing, which I added that was missing from the stock kit. And that rivet detailing extends all the way throughout the lower portion of the vehicle. The vehicle also has added diamond plate floorboards, which are somewhat difficult to see on film. However, the entire floorboard setup of this vehicle has diamond plate present. Like I said before, the model was a very simple assembly. Now, one caveat is that when you are assembling the top and bottom halves of the hull, the kit itself, like I said before, was assembled with fasteners originally. The fasteners, one side effect is that you would have large columns from the top and bottom portions of the hull that are in three sections here on the interior. These columns here are very unsightly and did require some alterations in order to not only get the hull halves together in one piece, nice and securely, but to thoroughly remove these molded in components, as they can be eyesores. In addition to the columns, the way the fenders mount into the lower hull is again via fasteners, and there are other mounting tabs which would have been found on the inside portion here of the hulls. These two had to have been deleted and thoroughly blended in with the bodywork in order to have the appropriate appearance like you see here on my model. As for the model's paint and markings, the model's painted with a Kharkov style pattern. As for the markings themselves are all applied via stencils, and all of the other divisional markings are all hand applied. There are no decals utilized on this build, just like I never utilize on any of the other builds that I showcase on my video listings. And that concludes this model showcase video for this 1/6 scale German SDKFZ 250 Alt Halftrack. If you like this video, stop by and like us on Facebook. And don't forget to check out eastcoastarmory.com for more 1/6 and 1/16 scale builds and detail components. Thank you.